Okay, good morning students again. Had a nice time solving your doubts, around 4 hours of it. So I think you all are really excited about your final lectures. That's very nice. So let's get to work. We had in the last session talked about the testes the male gonad produces sperms by a process called as spermatogenesis. From the testes, sperms pass into 15 to 20 delicate finger-like tubes which are called as vasa efferentia. From the vasa efferentia, sperms then pass into a structure called as the epididymis. So testes, vasa efferentia, epididymis. From the epididymis, sperms pass into tubes which are called as vasa differentia. From vasa differentia, they go into the ejaculatory ducts. Ejaculatory ducts say they will pass into the urethra, and at the same time that sperms pass into urethra, your seminal vesicles, prostate gland and Cowper's gland pass their secretion which mix with the sperms in the urethra. Urethra passes through the external organ called as the penis, and from the tip of the penis, sperms are released out of the semen. A phenomenon called as ejaculation takes place. So, testes produces sperms, and from the testes, sperms pass into 15 to 20 thin tubes which are called as vasa efferentia. Each vas efferens has in it cells which are called as ciliary cells. And these are ciliary cells. Ciliary cells mean cells with hair-like projections. If you remember, I told you in the fallopian tube, the egg moves with the help of cilia. Similarly, in the vasa efferentia, the sperms are moved forward not by the tail movement but with the help of ciliary cells which are found in the vasa efferentia. So sperms move by ciliary movements into the vasa efferentia, and from vasa efferentia, sperms now enter into the C-shaped or comma-shaped structure which is called as the epididymis. So from the testis, via ciliary action in the vasa efferentia, it passes into the epididymis. Each epididymis is present on the posterolateral side of the testis. Which side, sir? Posterolateral side. Now, what are these words in bio that you keep on coming through again and again? Sir, aaj hum log biology ke teen axis ke baare mein baat karte hain. The three axes, if we have a point of reference, anything above it is called as superior. Anything below is called as inferior. Anything in front is called anterior or ventral. Anything behind is called posterior or dorsal. Away from the midline is called lateral. And towards the midline is called as median. So once again, superior, inferior, anterior or ventral, posterior or dorsal, lateral, median. So we have cited a few examples. The nose is superior to the mouth. Vice versa, mouth is inferior to the nose. The heart is the ventral or anterior organ. The kidneys are dorsal or posterior organs. My, your is lateral compared to my eye. My eye is median compared to the ear. So once again, superior, inferior, anterior or ventral, posterior or dorsal, lateral, median. So these are the axes of the body. Where is the epididymis situated? It is situated posteriorly and laterally. So each epididymis is posterolateral, and that is the position, posterolateral to the testis. Each epididymis is a comma-shaped structure or a C-shaped structure made up of three distinct parts, namely a head, a body, and a tail. The head, body, and tail, the head is called as caput, C-A-P-U-T, caput. The body is called as the corpus, C-O-R-P-U-S, corpus. The tail is called cauda, C-A-U-D-A, cauda. You have the caput, corpus, and cauda. So here we have the head or the caput, we have the body or the corpus, we have the tail or the cauda. The head receives sperm via the vasa efferentia, and then from the head the sperms pass into the body and the tail by passing through a highly coiled tube which is called as the duct of epididymis. What is that coiled tube called as? Duct of epididymis. If we remove this duct of epididymis and we uncoil it, it covers a distance of 6 meters or 20 feet in length. And we begin to wonder, testis is about 5 centimeters and the duct of epididymis is 6 meters or 20 feet in length. Now why do we have such a long coil duct of epididymis? While passing through the duct of epididymis, sperms become physiologically mature. Their motility increases and their fertilizing capacity increases, and this takes 1 month. So, 1 month lagta hai for the sperms to become mature, and that is the reason they pass through a very long tube called as the duct of epididymis. Sperms first become mature. If you remember, in the testis, sperms are produced, but they are immature. Immature sperms require a temperature 3 degrees less than the normal body temperature. But once they will pass through the vasa differentia, they will enter into the abdominal cavity. And in the abdominal cavity, the temperature is high. Will the sperm survive that high temperature? Yes. Because while passing through the epididymis, the sperms have now become physiologically mature, and from a 34 degrees temperature, they can now survive a 37 degrees temperature, which is the temperature in the abdominal cavity. The sperms produced in the testis have got a head, body, and tail. But while they were immature, the tail does not move. While passing through the duct of epididymis, the sperms become mature, and after maturation, their tail movements will begin, which means now sperms become motile. And in the head of the sperm, develop certain chemicals, and those chemicals, when the sperms will be ejaculated, the sperm will enter the fallopian tube. The sperm, when it touches the egg, those chemicals will help the sperm to fertilize the egg and thereby help in formation of the zygote. So where are the chemicals which help in fertilization of the egg produced? In the head of the sperm, and these chemicals are produced while the sperms become matured within the epididymis. So while passing through epididymis, sperms become mature, which means they can survive high temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. The motility of the sperm will increase and sperms will develop chemicals in their head which will help in fertilization of the egg, so their fertilizing capacity will increase. After passing through the ducts of epididymis, for 1 month the sperms will become mature in the epididymis, and after 1 month they will now pass into tubes which are called as vasa differentia. Singular vas deferens, plural vasa differentia. Each vas deferens arises from the tail of the epididymis, passes upwards, enters in through the inguinal canal and goes inside the abdominal cavity, crosses over the ureter and joins the ejaculatory duct. So once again, sir, here we have the kidneys. From kidneys, urine is produced which will pass into tubes which are called as ureters. And from ureters, urine will now pass into urinary bladder. Then through the urethra, urine will go out of the penis. So we have kidneys, we have ureters, we have urinary bladder, we have urethra. This is your excretory system. And each vas deferens arises from the tail of the epididymis, passes upwards, enters the abdominal cavity, crosses over the ureter and joins the ejaculatory duct. Each vas deferens is about 18 inches in length and very muscular in its nature. It is capable of contraction and relaxation. And each vas deferens is covered all along its length by the spermatic cord. And if you remember, spermatic cord has in it vas deferens, blood vessels and nerves. So we remember the last lecture, there was a straw, we had a red thread, yellow thread, blue thread. Who is the straw? Spermatic cord. Who is the blue thread? Vas deferens. Red, blood vessels. Yellow, nerves. So vas deferens is covered all along its length by the spermatic cord, which we remember is an extension of the peritoneum. And sperms pass from the vas deferens all the way into the ejaculatory duct by continuous contractions and relaxations, which are movements called as peristaltic movements. I'm sure you remember in school you had done that. Food passes from the esophagus into the stomach by peristalsis. Similarly, from stomach, small intestine, large intestine, food passes by peristalsis. Similarly, in the vasa differentia, sperms pass up and into ejaculatory ducts by movements called as peristalsis. So sir, two types of movements ho gaye hai. In the vasa efferentia, we remember there was ciliary movements. And in the vasa differentia, Now we know there are peristaltic movements. And by peristalsis, sperms enter into the ejaculatory ducts on either side. Now, we have ejaculatory ducts. Ejaculatory ducts are thin ducts about 2 centimeters in length, formed by the fusion of the duct coming from the seminal vesicle and a small duct which comes from the vas deferens. Now, a nice point over here, when the ejaculatory duct is formed by seminal vesicle and vas deferens, the vas deferens at its tip will form a swollen area which is now called as the ampulla. So that is called ampulla of the vas deferens. And sperms are continuously produced by testes. They mature in the epididymis and there for peristalsis they will enter into the ampulla and sperms get stored in the ampulla. Now, ampulla is always closed. When the male goes into a libido, when he is sexually excited, the penis will undergo an erection and this erected penis is then inserted in the vagina, then the ampulla of the vas deferens will open and sperms start entering into the ejaculatory ducts. And once the sperms enter into the ejaculatory ducts, the sexual intercourse or copulation takes place. The penis is rubbed in the vagina and in the last phase of copulation, scientifically called as the climax. In the climax phase, also called as the orgasm phase. In the climax or the orgasm phase, the ejaculatory ducts undergo powerful contractions. And by powerful contractions of ejaculatory ducts, the sperms with semen zip into the urethra. And from the urethra, they pass forcefully out of the penis and that phenomenon is called as ejaculation. So, who helps in ejaculation? Contractions of the ejaculatory ducts help in the process of ejaculation. Hence, these are rightly called as ejaculatory ducts. So, ejaculatory ducts contract and bring about the process called as ejaculation. So, these are the ejaculatory ducts. And then we have the three glands. Seminal vesicles, prostate gland and Cowper's gland. We have a small break over here and we will understand the functioning of these three glands.